sitting here in November of last year, and I was talking about the shortfall. My comment at that time was, it's not quick enough. We're not seeing those gains quickly enough. And what the great news is that we put the right conditions in place. We retrained many of the managers in terms of level loading, scheduling, being able to avoid overtime. We've seen a 20% reduction in overtime, so that would be one. We've seen a leveling off of paid hours, which is total hours. So there's been a concerted effort to not only predict, but to staff to actuals. So if you know what your overcapacity is going to be, the idea here is to be able to staff accordingly, rather than act surprised and staff at overtime rates. So the equivalent, I mean, if, as you break this down, we have had some sustainability items that have proceeded. They started a lot longer before the board even approved them. Some of them can be acted upon because of the authority of the CEO. We've had, again, stabilization of paid hours and a reduction in overtime, and that's in spite of the 5% or thereabouts increase in growth. So once again, we're dealing with a similar challenge, which is population growth, demographic shift. So more to do, absolutely. Does this mean the challenge is over? No. We have a very significant challenge ahead of us, and we are on this, going to be persistent and achieve it. Whether or not we'll be able to, by the end of the year, balance is still a question mark. But we're going to do everything we can to work towards that while preserving patient safety, patient quality, and minimizing layoffs.
Right. So in an ideal world, mm-hmm. where end of the year, you know, you're on a good track, the budget is basically balanced, what will have had to have gone right to get to that spot?
Well, so I think all the conditions have been right. Mm-hmm. So there's always something more that can be done. We've taken a look at all of our services. We started with the challenge from the Premier around out-of-scope staffing, and certainly have put a hiring freeze in place, obviously looking at redeployment. And that was done far earlier than 2 months, or the last 2 months, or the projected 2 months of freezing of in-scope staff hiring. This has given us an opportunity to look internally, to ask every person on the team, to be able to come up with ideas that would bring down their spending. Some of that spending would be seen as, it's not like all of this is discretionary. Some of it would be seen as an opportunity to do things differently, to do less things, to do things, obviously the differently is in a different method or approach. So what does good look like? Good looks like a balanced budget, improved quality, improved safety. It really is our triple aim. Better health, better care, better value, sustainable delivery, and better teams. So I would expect that, and George or Nilesh can contribute to this, that we would have great teamwork. We'd be focused on the patient and what they actually need, not necessarily what we have available to offer them. We have many people, for instance, that are cared for in our acute care setting that ought not to be cared for here, and this is a clinical piece, if there were alternatives. And the beauty of what we've done in the last months, in fact, more than a year now, is that we have more options. You recall Sanctum and its establishment. When I said we were opening Sanctum, and these are million-dollar patients, that has a long-term impact on our sustainability going forward. So how many things are involved in achieving this? Triple digits, hundreds. And if I really were able to measure, there are so many initiatives that people have taken on their own accord to be able to create sustainability, I wouldn't even want to count them.
So what are the challenges then?
Challenges.
Are specific things you're worried about?
I'm still deeply concerned about the forecast. We have a great opportunity, first and foremost, on the financial side, to be able to use the software that Nilesh has established around forecasting a deficit. So I don't have to guess or unnecessarily worried. I'm worried legitimately because our forecasting tool is still saying somewhere between 25 and 30 million that we'll land as a deficit if we continue on the trajectory. Now, I'm pleased to say we're taking action, and there's continued action here. If we take a look at our sustainability plan overarching that we presented and discussed at the last go-around, last get-together, we're over 30% complete. But what that says is, over 50%, close to 60%, are the initiatives that are still in the mix, underway, and yet to be completed. I'm worried not just about the deficit and the forecast. And again, the worry is not just simple reflection, it's what are we going to do? And each and every day, coming up with new ideas and engaging literally 14,000 people, almost 1,000 physicians, in being able to curb our costs and still preserve those quadruple aims. I'm worried about flow. I think that word has not resonated as much as it could or should. What it comes down to is there are still patients that are in our ER waiting for beds. There are still patients that have been and continue to be cared for off service. In other words, in the wrong place. When I say they're being cared for in the wrong place, I don't mean they're not receiving care. I just said we are staffing those places, but it's not ideal. It's not ideal. So as long as we're in a situation of overcapacity, I'm not going to sleep in terms of or rest easily in terms of quality of care.
So I'm glad you mentioned the patient flow aspect because that's one aspect of this plan here. And so I'm seeing here it says redesign our system for centralized access to alternate level of care services. What does that mean exactly?
Well, it sounds pretty impressive, doesn't it? It doesn't really say much. Let me just describe for you. And these days are early. We're doing some early work. And again, George, as a clinician, can kick in on this. Our system, and this is Canada-wide, is ill-designed to care for those that are presenting. A lot of people can be critical about who ends up in the emergency room. And many people take the stance, well, that's abuse. In fact, the vast majority of what's there, the people that are there seeking care, you could probably say it's misuse. They don't have an alternative. And so one of the priorities of the board is to create more doors, more opportunities, more alternatives. So if that's not the place it should be, then where? So extending hours of our services makes sense. But the biggest challenge is those that have complex care needs. So the days of one visit to a physician, 10, 15 minutes, getting it sorted out, you're young enough, you probably are able to do that. But when you start to get my age, maybe George's age, maybe Nilesh, he's not as young as he seems or looks. When you get into this area, the likelihood of having multiple chronic illness and that complexity, you can't sort out an emergency room. You just can't sort out a 20-minute doctor's visit. What you need is a different kind of care. And healthcare is an interesting thing because it's not like every good or service. If you get the wrong stuff or you get too much of it, it's not a good, it's a bad. And in fact, we know that that one door is probably the most expensive door we have. And worse yet, we're not meeting the needs. So, George?
Well, I think one of the things that that concerns me is that not only are we in a deficit, but every year we're seeing more population. So we're getting 3 to 4% more people coming through our doors. And with the same resources that we have. And in fact, we're trying to save money in this. And it's like trying to fix an airplane when it's flying, because we're still flying all the time, but we have to keep fixing it. The other thing that concerns me, if you look at the demographics, and to me this is very personal, it's the baby boomers. The baby boomers are coming. In our region, we have over, 3,000 people who are over the age of 90. So, and that's just the start of the baby boomer generation coming. I'm at it right now. So as people age, of course, you end up with more illnesses, more requirement for services, and more need for care. So there's more than just the fact that we have to look at the money that we're saving, but we have to look at the volumes that we're looking at and the type of people that we're going to have to serve. So it's quite a critical situation for us right now. The other issue is, and we've talked about alternate level of care, right now we have approximately 80 to 100 alternate level of care patients in our acute care system.
In other words, George, they'd be better served elsewhere.
They would be better served in an alternate care location.
So those are people who aren't well enough to be really anywhere but the hospital, but ideally they wouldn't be in the hospital, it'd be somewhere.
Ideally they would be in some other form of care.
But let me turn that around, because you said ideally wouldn't be in the hospital.
Mm-hmm. Like using an inpatient bed, I mean.
So what we have is a situation where there are no good alternatives. And a lot of people can come to this conclusion or solution, it's an easy fix, just build more beds. The bottom line is we're really still not getting at what needs to be gotten at. The whole approach to complex care is to try and navigate a myriad of service. So we not only have multiple chronic illness, as George has said, we have frail elderly who are best supported in the community, if possible, are best supported and caregivers supported through respite, palliative care we've talked about. This takes a transformation of the health system. This is much more than just simply solving a current budget issue. It's about redesigning the systems, and we use the term sustainability, to be sustainable and to improve.
So if it's not the emergency room door, then which door is it going to be? And that sounds to me like there's going to be some sort of capital spending or something to build a door somewhere, no matter where it's going to be.
Our days of building are over. Again, we'll try and renovate, we'll try and improve the services that are core to our mandate. We're looking to the community, but we need to plan. We need to identify what the configuration looks like. So in my view, and this is before the analysis, and I'm always guarded against speculation, but I would say one of the basic problems in this community, in this region, is after-hours care. So it doesn't mean after midnight. That's generally a low-volume time. But if you take a look at the hours between 5 or 6 and 10 or 11 at night, these are areas where, what options do you really have? There are a few areas clinics that open up from time to time, but there is no clear and consistent service strategically placed in multiple areas within the city where you can go seek what I would refer to as urgent care. The second of all, if we're going to deliver complex care, I mentioned that's not just a 10 or 20 minute visit, what we need to do is have a team. And that team may be formed around seniors. It could be formed around children. By the way, this is good news, bad news, right? The great news about seniors is they're living longer than ever in our history. The challenge, though, is that they're also living long enough to get multiple chronic illness. With children, the great news is we're saving lives every day. Those new babes that perhaps wouldn't have survived in the past, great technology, great approaches, great life-saving measures. But there are also complexity. There's complexity of care. So the children's hospital and our services and supports. So when you're living in the community with complex care needs, we need to wrap around you and provide service. Westside is another example. So we see, I mentioned Sanctum, I mentioned the million-dollar clients. It's really a matter of asking ourselves the question, who keeps on rebounding in and out of the emergency department because they don't have a better alternative? And if they need a better alternative, what is that better alternative? And if that's the case, where should it be located? So we've got a whole range of considerations. Right now, we're busy developing a project plan around this. By the end of December, my target, our target, the board's target, is to receive an options paper that literally lays out options and recommendations around this. So we're not going to solve everything. What we're going to do is start to move towards the direction of saying there's got to be a better way. And that better way is out there in the community. That better way is a range of teams that are established to provide the care needs to support people with the care needs that they have.
Can you, are there any jurisdictions you can look to, other provinces that maybe have this more sorted, some of the models you're looking at?
It's all over the map. And in fact, some countries have done much, much better than we have. I think it's fair to say primary care is probably the root of the issue.
It's part of the thing.
Yeah.
There are many jurisdictions in Canada who are having actually the absolutely same issues that we are with this. It's variable. Some are doing a little bit better. Some are doing quite a bit worse. There's no magic bullet for this. It is actually, I think a lot of it is adjusting our expectations for what we're going to be receiving when we look for care. And I think a lot of it is also looking at doing care in new ways and other ways than we have done before. We've traditionally relied on the acute care hospital to be the center of all our care. And we really have to look at perhaps having other areas that we should access our care with rather than just acute care hospital. And I think that'll take a little bit of time,
yeah.
But I think we have to move to that because number one, it is better care. You know, it's if you go into a hospital, there's a lot of things that can happen to you. You get hospital-acquired infections, things of this nature. So it's always better not to go to a hospital if you can, and it's better to get care somewhere else.
This is whatever's going to be coming from this advisory panel, how much is that going to complicate what you're trying to do here, if at all?
Well, to be truthful, the only way we can operate is just to ignore
okay.
the external noise. There will be changes, and we acknowledge those changes, and we look optimistically the opportunity for the system to improve through those changes. But we're not speculating.
Okay.
What we're doing is just simply doing our job, and we'll do that as long as we can until the change is made.
Can you tell me about the rural strategy that's mentioned in here?
Yeah, for sure. So these are early days. What we're thinking about with the rural strategy is really looking at our quality improvement approach through the lens of what services are best suited for rural Saskatchewan. I think what happens is the fear in the rural areas is that somehow they have all or nothing. They don't have the services that are readily available on the hours that are required. They fear losing their family physician. They fear closure of their facilities. And what we'd like to do, first and foremost, is stabilize services. Done some great work in the past few years. Stabilize the right services as well. So those extended hours, not dissimilar to what we were talking about with the ER,
mm-hmm.
Also complex care for the frail elderly, home care, home-based services. And the vision goes something like this. What we need to do is create teams that provide a whole range of services, not only in facility, but throughout the community. So that you don't end up with providers traveling from a central area back and forth with a lot of windshield time. What we're trying to do is minimize the windshield time. Also, really consider the client, the patient, the resident. If every time they need something, they have to travel to the city, then that is the problem. So we see and view rural Saskatchewan as having great strengths in terms of bread and butter testing, bread and butter diagnostics, access to the right services and practitioners. Yes, there will be some windshield time because not everyone can be located given population. But wherever possible, even if it costs a little more, if from the patient's point of view, they have to travel quite a bit less, that's worth considering. So the rural strategy hasn't been nailed down, but we do know that we need to better serve rural Saskatchewan. And what tells us that? Our emergency department in Saskatoon. Growth, there's also been a demographic shift. And in addition to that, we're facing the demographics of rural Saskatchewan, beyond our borders. So I think, Nilesh, you might have that number.
Depending on the service, I mean, overall, our inpatient services, about 30%, 30 to 33% of our inpatient services are out-of-region patients. Most of those are rural patients. Again, it depends on the service. When you look at maternal services, you know, it could be as high as more than 40%.
Yeah.
That's actually surprisingly high.
It is. But we're a tertiary center,
yeah.
Right? So the other piece of this, Jonathan, is that we not only serve those centers, but the decisions of those health regions have a direct impact on us. So how they design, how they support, how they match their care to the care needs of their population, that actually affects how many people are coming through that high cost set of doors. So we're saying community based, we're saying supports and support people where they are, not expect people to either travel long distances or come in, except for those things more specialized that require, you know, those types of providers that are difficult to recruit and retain. What we'd like to do is make sure there's a range of services that just makes sense here for the care needs that are required.
Last couple things. What's in the cards for the City Hospital Emergency Department?
Well, stay tuned. What we're wanting to do is give consideration to hours, to delivery. And when I was signaling December, I mean, that's going to be really a telling time in terms of not just City Hospital, but Royal University Hospital, St. Paul's Hospital. We're looking at all the emergency departments, not just one. So how should they be configured if they're not this kind of walk-in clinic center, if they decant and other services are made available in the community? Then really, what should those emergency departments be? We have a pilot underway, probably close to a year now, around trauma care. We've had some great advances around stroke care. City Hospital, for instance, people talk about its acuity and acute care services. It's the busiest operating center in Saskatchewan, surgical center. So what City Hospital is, it's a gift to us in terms of giving us the flex and the flexibility to be providing services and actually shifting those services between the Children's Hospital and City Hospital and St. Paul's Hospital and RUH. We're gonna be able to really take a look at our services and see if we can readjust how we deliver those services. So I'd love to be able to tell you RUH emergency department will be this or that. Those answers will come soon enough. But I can tell you that the current design, it ain't working.
Lastly, since the idea of the sustainability plan we first talked about last year, the idea of job cuts is sort of always...
Right.
To my knowledge, there haven't been a lot, if any, sort of large numbers of layoffs, unless I've missed something.
Yeah, no. So you'll recognize this. Last time we met,
mm-hmm.
I had mentioned that we're going to try and avoid as
yes.
many layoffs as possible. I regret, unfortunately, that we're not going to be able to avoid layoffs. There will be layoffs. The reason why I haven't laid those all out for you is that we believe as an organization that those staff deserve to hear first, and they will. We're going to be able to issue those layoffs, but our intent remains.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to try and minimize that impact. And I can tell you there's been a great deal of work. Success that's been shown through reduction in paid hours that I just mentioned. Success of it that's been shown in our hiring freeze. That hiring freeze has meant that there's been an internal movement that's occurred. And when someone moves, their job is either filled, creating another vacancy, or it's left. So we have this great opportunity now to create savings without laying anyone off. And that's more the job protection great, but time's of the essence. And being still concerned about the deficit, there will be labs.
Sure. Do you know how many or what fields are going to be?
I know.
Can you give a hint as to what?
I wouldn't want to, just for the sake
sure.
of wanting to make sure. Now, you're going to hear it in the community.
Yeah.
You're going to hear it. We'll be more than willing and happy to respond to any concerns that you hear.
Okay.
It's just too bad we couldn't have spent a little more time, but taking a few more. The time is of the essence. We just have to be able to move this.
I mean, the other side of that is one of the pressures you're facing financially is growing demographics. At the same time, in order to balance that budget, you have to look at a hiring freeze and possibly layoffs. How do you keep the number of staff that you need to service the growing population when you're eliminating jobs?
Once again, on the acute care side, and that seems to be a major focus these days, we've had the opportunity to use our predictive model that was created. Actually, Nilesh and his team
mm-hmm.
were headed up that important piece of work. We get to staff to need, as opposed to staff hoping, wondering, and speculating on what might happen this weekend. So that has meant not only the avoidance of overtime, but also right staffing the services. You provide staffing for the care that's needed, not just in case. We also have looked at and made sure through the staffing freeze, and you recall last year, we recruited a great number of registered nurses. We felt, and we proved it to be true, that while the thinking was we need fewer, we actually knew that the lack of nurses meant we had to incur overtime. Well, what has happened in the months since is that we've found more nurses are working part-time and casual. And when checking in with them, it's not for choice. So the feeling was that freeze not only allowed for vacancies to be created, but also for those internally that were working casual part-time to build more hours. Actually helps with sustainability. It helps with those that experience that's so important.
How many RNs did you hire? Do you remember?
I can't remember the number. It was documented. I think it was...
It's in the range of about 60.
60, yeah.
And that was exactly how long ago?
We did that right at graduation time. So it would have been...
Between April
May,
and July.
Eight, yeah.
Okay. Was there anything else? I don't think so. Anything else? Covered a lot of ground there. Anything else you want to mention, you think is important, anything else the people of Saskatoon you'd like them to know?
Well, we continue to be committed. And we're committed to patient, to the residents of a long-term care facility, and the clients that we serve through home care and other community-based services. That commitment means that we're trying to minimize any negative impact. It means if we have the opportunity to improve, never waste a crisis. This is a great time to improve services as well. We're committed to trying to work with our union partners and minimize layoffs.
Mm-hmm.
At times, because of the nature of our collective agreements, a layoff doesn't necessarily mean a job loss. The collective agreements may be worded in such a way that a job change, the only way to change someone's position to some other priority, is through layoff. So that important relationship with working with unions is to further prevent layoff bumping, and those types of issues. We have, and you heard it at the meeting, we have a great partnership that's building with physicians, with clinicians. And we're trying to create the types of teams, and this isn't all about physicians, this is about the teams that are necessary to really focus in on the care needs of those they care for. And I'm holding out great hope. And these are not my ideas, by the way.
Right.
It's important to note that 14,000 people every day are doing the work that's necessary.
Oh, you mentioned sick time has still been really stubborn.
Yeah.
What's going on there?
Well, it persists. Obviously, either not enough, or of whatever it is. What I said at the board meeting is we have not gotten to the root cause. A lot of speculation. You know, everyone has an idea of how it could be solved. But I got to tell you, it's a negotiated collective agreement provision. There is obviously something that's driving the needs. You know, it could be aging of the workforce, and we've seen with new hires, that's stabilized a bit. It could be, I mean, we could just continue to speculate. If I knew what it was, I'd deal with it right now.
Right.
So what, one of the things you'll see different in this budget approach than previous, I think it was StarPhoenix that, the StarPhoenix that really legitimately pointed out that we keep on beating on the same drum. And we haven't really spoken about sick time. We'd love to be able to resolve the issues. What we're really after is a staff that's healthy. And so when you look at this, we'd love to resolve those issues, but they've been evasive. Like every time we push on something, something else balloons out. So I talked about partnerships. We now are working provincially on having these conversations and seeing what we can do. There's got to be interventions. We're also looking across the country and across the globe. Mm-hmm. We're looking at other industries and promising practices. We're also seeking the best of the best in terms of the advice we need to be able to tackle this.
Yeah.
Just not there yet.
Sure. Thanks very much.